Hello students, welcome to today's English class. So today we are going to discuss the prose, What is the Language of the Future? This is written by Henry Hitchings. Henry Hitchings was born in 1974. He grew up mainly in Surrey in South England, Southern England. He studied English literature at Oxford and he obtained his PhD from the University College, London. His first book is Dr. Johnson's Dictionary was published in 2005. Other notable works that we can find are The Secret Life of Words, How English Became English, published in 2008. Who is Afraid of Jane Austen? How to Really Talk About Books You Haven't Read, published in 2008. And Sorry, The English and Their Manners, published in 2013. He has recently edited a collection of essays also. It is about bookshops and it is titled Browse the World in Bookshops. He has contributed to many newspapers and also magazines. He is also a theatre critic for London Evening Standard. He became a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature in 2015. So here fourth semester students, we have an extract, What is the Language of Future, written by Henry Hitchings. It is an excerpt from Hitchings' book, The Language Wars, A History of Proper English. It was published in 2011. So in this prose, he gives an account of the debates that actually shaped the English language. He also provides a deep insight into the state of language, English language today, and also he talks about its possibilities and challenges in a likely future. So in this particular essay, he talks about the factors that helped in spreading English language in the past. So that is how he begins this particular essay. He says that, he also says that there is a kind of English fever which emphasizes the spread of language in the present. So this extract also discusses the challenges that English language is likely to face in future. So let's read the first two paragraphs of this excerpt. You can open your textbook or you can just look at the screen that I have given here. So it begins like this. The prose begins in this way. No language has spread as widely as English, and it continues to spread. Internationally, the desire to learn it is insatiable. In the 21st century, the world is becoming more urban and more middle class, and the adoption of English is a symptom of this. For increasingly, English serves as the lingua franca of business and popular culture. It is dominant, or at least very prominent, in other areas such as shipping, diplomacy, computing, medicine, and education. A recent study has suggested that among students in the United Arab Emirates, Arabic is associated with tradition, home, religion, culture, school, arts, and social sciences, whereas English is a symbolic of modernity, work, higher education, commerce, economics, and science and technology. In Arabic-speaking countries, science subjects are often taught in English because excellent textbooks and other educational resources are readily available in English. This is not something that has come about in an unpurposed fashion. The propagation of English is an industry, not a happy accident. So English has spread because of British colonialism, the technological advances of Industrial Revolution, American economic and political ascendancy, and further technological developments in the second half of the 20th century. Its rise has been assisted by the massive exportation of English as a second language, as well as by the growth of English language mass media. So let us discuss these two paragraphs. So he has specifically spoken about the advent of English language and how it has spread in different parts of the country. What are the reasons for its prominence in different fields like shipping, computing, science, medicine, and all that? And native language synonymous with home, religion, and tradition. He has given the example of Arabic here. English is often seen as a symbol of modernity. So if we look at the history of English language, we understand that even from 17th century onwards, Britishers began extending their language all over the world. So there are a certain important factors like British colonialism, which happened in 17th and 18th centuries, and also Industrial Revolution, which happened in 18th and 19th century, which resulted in the prominence of British English during that time. Then after certain years, English has become a global language. So it is the lingua franca. It is the language that connects different places. So it is a global language and also the language of international and multinational companies and industries. So English spread as the language of American economic superiority and also political leadership during the 19th and 20th centuries. And after that, in the latter part of 20th century, we can see that English became much widespread as a consequence of American technological domination. It is during this time that we can see a boom of MNCs, this internet and all that coming into being, and we find that English is also a major language of internet. So we'll go to the third paragraph in this essay, what is the language of future, and let us start reading the paragraph. Today it is English that is the world's auxiliary tongue. There are more people who use English as a second language than there are native speakers. Estimates of the numbers vary, but even the most guarded view is that English has 500 million second language speakers. Far more of the world's citizens are eagerly jumping on board than trying to resist its progress. In some cases, the devotion appears religious and can involve what to outsiders looks a lot like self-mortification. According to Mark Abley, some rich Koreans pay for their children to have an operation that lengthens the tongue because it helps them speak English convincingly. The suggestion is that it enables them to produce R and E sounds, although the evidence of many proficient English speakers among Korean immigrants in America and Britain make one wonder whether the procedure is either necessary or useful. Still, it is a powerful example of the lengths people will go in order to learn English, seduced by the belief that linguistic capital equals economic capital. So English is actually first language for native speakers. For Britishers and Americans and all, English is called first language. It is their native language. It is their mother tongue. While for other speakers, for language, for people of other different native languages, English is a second language or it is a foreign language. So the writer calls English world's auxiliary tongue. So it is a helping language. It is a supplementary language connecting people from different parts of the world. There are more than 500 million second language speakers. So people are very eager to learn English. Many consider it embarrassing if they cannot speak English comfortably. And he also gives that example of Koreans, the extent to which Koreans will go to have an operation done to lengthen their tongue and speak English convincingly. So these are the kinds of procedures that they would go to These are the extreme steps that they take to speak English comfortably, fluently. So are these kinds of procedures necessary? We have to think about that. Why are people not ready to resist the progress of English language? Many people are seduced or attracted by the belief that this linguistic capital, language capital, equals economic capital. And English is the lingua franca of business, travel, international relations and all. You can find the soft power of US culture and also the relative ease in which one can learn English language are two reasons which make English dominant in the world stage or all over the world. Now let us read the second paragraph in this page. There are challenges to the position of English as the dominant world language in the 21st century. So there are certain challenges to the position of English. What are those challenges? Let us look at it. The main ones seem likely to come from Spanish and Mandarin Chinese. Both have more first language users than English, but at present neither is much used as lingua franca. The majority of speakers of Mandarin Chinese live in one country, and excepting Spain, most Spanish speakers are in the Americas. So the main challenge comes from Spanish and Mandarin Chinese. Both these languages have more first language users than second or foreign language. We don't have much foreign language users for these two languages. If you read about these languages in detail, you can find that there are around 317 million people who speak Mandarin Chinese. There are 1.3 billion native speakers for Chinese. And if you look at Spanish, there are 460 million native speakers. English has only 379 million native speakers. So according to the present data, 753, it is not 500 now. It is 753 million people who speak English as a second language. Now let us read the next paragraph, the paragraph starting with the main challenges. The main challenges to English may come from within. There is a long history of people using the language for anti-English ends. That is, of creative artists and political figures asserting in English their distance from Englishness or Britishness or Americanness. For instance, many writers whose first language has not been English have infused their English writing with foreign flavors. This has enabled them to parade their heritage while working in a medium that has made it possible for them to reach a wide audience. Two challenges stand out. One of them is India. English is important to its global ambitions. The language's root, there are colonial, but English connects Indians less to the past than to the future. Already, the language is used by more people in India than in any other country, the United States included. Meanwhile, in China, the number of students learning the language is increasing rapidly. The entrepreneur Li Yang has developed Crazy English, an unorthodox teaching method of English. It involves a lot of shouting, it seems. This, Li explained, is a way for Chinese to activate their international muscles. His agenda is patriotic. One of Li's slogan is conquer English to make China strong. A few dissenting voices suggest that he is encouraging racism, but the enthusiasm for his populistic approach is no doubt and is a symptom for China's English fever. The ardent conviction that learning English is the essential skill for surviving in the modern world. The embrace of English in world's two populous countries mean that language is changing. Some of the changes are likely to prove disconcerting for its native speakers. The Englishness of English is being diluted, and so more surprisingly, its American flavor. English center of gravity is moving. In fact, in the 21st century, the language has many centers. As this continues, native English speakers may find themselves at a disadvantage. Non-native speakers of English often comment that they find conversing with one another easier than sharing talk with native speakers. Already many people who learn English do so with little or no intention of conversing with native users. Now here in all these paragraphs, he is talking about the challenges that English language face. Many writers whose first language has not been English have started infusing their English writing with their native language, with the flavors of their native language. This he calls anti-English, and so we can see there is a distancing from the American English or British English. We are introducing our own native elements into our English. We have an Indian English in which we can find that there are a lot of terms introduced in English. There are a lot of native terms. You can find Hindi terms, you can find Telugu terms, you can find Tamil terms introduced into English. So two challenges stand out. One, English is important to its global ambitions, and we are learning English now. Many of us are learning English for its global purpose. The root of the language is actually colonial, but nowadays English connects people to the future. We are not looking into the past anymore. We are looking to the future. Many in India use English when compared to other countries. Similar is the case with China. So we can find the two most populated countries are following so much of English. The number of students learning English is increasing rapidly in China. And you can find the slogan that is mentioned by the entrepreneur Li: conquer English to make China strong, because only if we learn English we can have a relation with other countries. So they are convinced that learning English is the essential skill for surviving in this modern society, modern world. So for some, English is synonymous with opportunities and also better quality of life. But we understand that the language is changing. Even English language is changing. The Englishness of English is getting diluted. It is no more the same British English or the same American English. And many people outside the native places, they learn a language with no intention of conversing with its native users. So here, at the same time, native speakers of English tend to assume that their ability in this potent language makes it unimportant to learn other languages. They think their language is much superior and they do not have to learn other languages. The reality is different. British companies often miss out an opportunity, export opportunities, because of a lack of relevant language skills. Moreover, there is a chance that a command of English will be within 20 or 30 years be regarded as a basic skill for business, and native speakers of the language will no longer enjoy any competitive advantage, because people from all over the world are learning English as second language or as foreign language. So other people, people other than native speakers will also speak English equally fluently. When polled in 2005, more than 80% of people in Netherlands, Denmark and Sweden claimed to be able to speak English. The figure was around 60% in Finland, 50% in Germany, 30% in France and Italy, and 20% in Spain and Turkey. So the number keeps on increasing over the period of time. So in future, everybody will learn to speak English and there wouldn't be a special advantage for native speakers. These figures can be safely assumed to have increased. They come from a study published in 2006 by the British Council, an organization set up in 1934 and today operating as an international cultural relations body. So you might have heard about the British Council, which teaches British English. It is there in more than 100 countries. In 1989, its Director General, Sir Richard Francis, stated that Britain's real black gold is not North Sea oil, but the English language. So they value their English language a lot, British English language. That view is often played down, but the role of British Council in promoting British English ties in with the British corporate interest. So they have their own corporate interest behind teaching British English. Large companies such as British Petroleum have worked with British Council, funding educational schemes to encourage foreign nationals to learn English. So they have also come in contract with large companies to teach foreign nationals English. This is not exactly educational schemes to encourage foreign nationals to learn. This is not exactly an act of altruism. As Robert Phillipson punchily says, English for business is business for English. But while English is being pushed, it is also being pulled. It is the language more than any other that people want to learn. So this is not an act of pure altruism. It is not a selfless act. Okay, they have some selfish concern behind that. They just want to promote British English. The consequences are complex. Some, it would seem, are not as intended. Even as vast amounts are spent on spreading British English, the reality is that English is taking on more and more local color in the different places where it is used. Accordingly, while the number of languages in the world is diminishing, the number of Englishes is increasing. So you can find that there are a lot of varieties of Englishes that are increasing. So you can find Indian words are included in dictionaries. Recently, even the word IO was added into dictionary. So you can find an adoption of Indian elements into English. Salman Rushdie has spoken about Chutneyfication in one of his writings. So Hitchings, Henry Hitchings, in the end of his essay concludes by saying that the number of languages in the world are diminishing, but then the number of Englishes is increasing. The facts, this fact comes with the globalization of language. Around the world, English does not say the same. So it has varieties and most of the native language elements are incorporated into English language. So English speaking countries they also speak different varieties of English. If you go to Britain, you can find British English. If you go to America, you can find American English, Australian English, Canadian English and so on. So even their languages are varied. So we cannot go for one English and we don't see a future of one English. So that is all. Let us discuss a few glossary given here, a few words given in the glossary. Insatiable means impossible to satisfy or impossible to quench the thirst. Next is lingua franca. Lingua franca is the link language, that is a language used for communication. So English is a kind of connecting language, connecting different groups of people. Unpurposed means without any purpose, without any intention. Propagate means to make public, to publicize something. Ascendance is gaining power. Auxiliary means helping, supplementing. Mortification is a feeling of being very embarrassed or shame. So if you don't know English, you are in a case of shame. So many people think like that. Infuse is to fill something, to introduce something as if by pouring. Entrepreneur is someone who starts their own business. Unorthodox is not orthodox, not very conventional. Dissent is opposition. Racism is a belief that people from other races are not worthy. Ardent, enthusiastic. Conviction is a strong belief. Disconcerting. Disconcerting means you are getting very confused. Center of gravity means an imaginary point. You know the center of gravity. It's an imaginary point in a body of matter where the total weight of the body may be thought to be concentrated. Potent is powerful. Tie-in means you have a harmonious relationship. Altruism is selflessness. Diminish to become less. So I hope you have enjoyed listening to this lesson. Thank you, students.